And welcome back. Welcome, new party member, Aratus. Hello? What are you doing? I smell a feast nearby, don't you? Okay, we need to get back to... Circus Minor from here? Okay. I know I can get to Cliff's Edge. Or I can get to Caravanserai via Cliff's Edge. So let's party with him a little bit and we'll take the, you know, the other area so we could get right to Caravanserai when we do that. Mother Tamaz. Hello, Mother. This woman glares at the air above her head, her fingers fretting with a single bead and a long, peculiar chain of them. Her low, angry muttering resolves into words as you get closer. Foolish girl. Doesn't matter what you were. The past is a land populated by wet-eyed nitwits. Nay, what matters is where you are, what you be. Who are you speaking to? She blinks at the empty air, and her hands steal to a metallic, many-faceted bead near the end of the chain. No one you know, she says, scowling at you. But should, mayhap. Hello there. You have an audience, or your audience has increased, anyway. Mother Tamaz knows you, girl. Born falling you were. Born in flame, shreds of your smoldering caul streaming through the air. When you struck ground, your bead first went cold, then hotter than a mother's hatred. She spits and shakes her head. Scarcely born you are, and already tangled in the past, seeking answers when you should be making your own. How do you know who I am? That's no mystery, girl, she says, flapping her hands at you. Have your bead, don't I? Formed it from a pinch of the caul. I hear your thoughts as clear as the moonlight in a cup. You're confused, but that'll change. You'll have your feet under you soon enough. Not all of my children are as lucky.
Updated my journal.
Ha! Awesome! Updated my journal. Love it. Okay. This one, she says, showing you the bead she was speaking to before you arrived. It's carved in the shape of two overlapping spheres. Something's eating her memories, her thoughts, even her name. She calls herself Loss of Self, and she's going mad. Her fingers fold over the bead. Set her back on her feet for me, girl. Do that, and I'll return your call to you, improved through my art, and stronger than when you lost it. Huh. How can I help Loss of Self? You haven't been listening, girl, she says with a sigh. Don't help her. Convince her to help herself. Where can I find her? She's... Mother Tamaz trails off, closing her hands around her beads, staring into space. In Cliff's Edge. Look around. You'll find her. So she's here. In Cliff's Edge. You'll find her if you look for her. I have questions about something else. Go on, then, she says, sighing. You mentioned you had my call. That's not what it is. I'm not a fool, girl, she says dryly. But you were born above my city, so I know you, like or not. She reaches into the bag strapped to her hip. Something glitters within. This is your call, torn from you at birth. Name it what you will, but know what it be. What it is. Can I have a look at my call? When you finish the task I asked of you, not before. I have some questions about you. Waste of time, she grumbles. I'd rather you lend your hand to the favor I asked of you, but ask and be done. Why do people call you Mother? I've delivered every child of a mortal womb in Cliff's Edge, she says. A smile slips unbidden onto her face, and some who are not. I'm the midwife of Cliff's Edge, other places as well, but this is where I hang my hooks and tongs. Do you have any children of your own? This guy keeps walking back and forth. Nay, none, and never have, in fact. But as the saying goes, all children in Cliff's Edge have two mothers. That's better than having one of my own. Do you like living in Cliff's Edge? Still here, aren't I? She says, wrapping the chain of beads around her fingers. I like having my children all around me. Why do you care about loss of self? I can't not, she says, twisting the many-faceted bead between her thumb and forefinger. I'm not like you, girl. Caring is what lines my spine and holds me upright. Tell me about that chain of beads you're holding. I make one for every child I deliver, made with wood and their mother's blood, carved in the shape of their soul. Touching their beads tells me if they're well, or more often, if they're not, and need a mother's help. She tilts an eyebrow at you. Sometimes I just witness a birth, but I still carve a bead to mark the occasion, if I think the child is worth remembering. I've made a bead for every child I delivered, she says, holding up the long, long chain. They tell me how my children are faring. I want to ask you about someone in particular. I? A note of wary caution enters Mother Tamaz's voice, and she drops the chain to coil, snake-like, into the palm of her hand. Matkina. She listens as you describe the woman you're seeking and begins to shake her head. Then she recoils. You're speaking of the White Death, she growls, gripping the ends of the chain of beads in her hands and pulling them taut until all of them shiver on their string. Mark the faded ones well. The ones as cold as a long night's snow. More than a few are down to her and her careful, careless knife. Careful and careless knife? The White Death, she says, lips curling. My children fall to sickness most often. Some to foolish accidents, some to murderers. Your Matkina is no humble assassin, but a plague in her own right. Lord Vunken. He's a leader of one of the slave families, she says, studying her beads casually. Has a number of opinions, that boy. Some he shares, some he doesn't. But he's got them all the same. She thinks, I'm not one to share his secrets, neither. Ruining a life is his business, not mine. I have nothing more to say about the man, she adds, but head over there with your mind open. He'd be happy to fill it for you. Why doesn't he like the Stitcher? Couldn't say, she says with a sniff. I'm not one for politics, or politicals for that matter. You tell me anything else about him? Plumb his depths yourself. I'll have no part in your curiosities. You don't seem to like Lord Vunken much. Can he be trusted or not? I'm just going to take two on this. Good. It didn't matter that much to me. She presses her lips together, eyes flickering between the distant lord and you. Yovaki blood on his mother's side, she says at last, so low you can barely hear her. I'll not turn my back on a girl in trouble, but I have no time for disgusting abhumans, either. She shoots a poisonous look in the lord's direction. I'm not alone in that. If people knew what he was, it would be the end of his politicking for sure and certain. As I said, in confidence, he has Yovaki blood in him. See it there in the yellow, sagging skin. Would be the end of him, if people knew. Huh. I thought he was just, like, you know, heavy. Rin. You describe the girl you're seeking, and she runs the chain of beads to her loosely coiled fist. Didn't deliver her, she declares. Don't know her. She doesn't come from Cliff's Edge, and may not be from Sagas either. Or neither. She's not from here, sure. Farewell. Stay safe, girl. There you go.
Without doubt.
Isn't Eritus gonna come with us? He's just staying there. Good idea.
In an instant.
He's not moving. Okay, whatever. I run a respectable boarding house. At least, it used to be before that priest moved in. Alright, let's talk to Hawker. Yeah, he's talking, but he's not moving. I think that was him talking. Hawker. Oh, what is this? The purpose of this protrusion eludes you, but the fact that there is one of them lined up with each outlet pipe emerging from a cliff wall can't be a coincidence. Insulting truths here, free of charge. My house collapsed a few weeks back. Weren't much, but it were mine. Your breath is bad, just awful. Like your tongue died in your mouth. Oh, what a sweetie. I guess that was her talking about free of charge. Discretion and secrecy, etc. There's another Hawker here. What's through here? Underbelly. That's all you can expect from Hargo the Fence. I know that look. Wondering why the Levies aren't all over me, eh? Trade secret, plotter. This skull-like relief could be a warning, or perhaps notice that something harmless but related to death waits below. There's a dragon. Free advice given here. Blunt, tailored advice. Oh, here's someone drunk. The mural above the door depicts five people, their positioning suggesting trade and camaraderie. Threads. Shreds. Tendons bending. Miravera goon. Look at this thing. Don't mind my scowling friend there. Doesn't trust strangers much. Don't remember asking you to join the conversation. Maybe you should walk away. What is this? The continual rise and fall of the pistons on this device suggests a massive mechanical effort. Structural similarities with the pipes in the area hint at them being part of the same machine. Medelia glittering? A forlorn woman stands by the edge of the cliff, only a few broken stones marking the remnants of a home that must have recently collapsed into the ocean. Three tiny rodents, each in its own strong glass ball, waver around her head in an indecipherable pattern. On her left shoulder sits a cat with synsteel legs, who bats lazily at the orbs whenever one ventures close enough. Oh, I need to... I should zoom in while we're in dialogue, but I can't. I need to get a better look at that when we're done. After a few moments, she notices you, as if coming back into herself. Oh, hello. She rummages in a pocket of her dress and produces a bundled cloth that she unrolls at her feet. A few trinkets gleam dully against the material. Is there anything I can do to help? Her eyes burn with unsettling zeal. If you come across something called a Stitcha, kill it. They took my home from me. She bares her teeth in a motion that isn't a smile. Kill every last one of them, and maybe I'll be able to sleep again without screaming myself awake. Have you seen an albino woman around here? I don't know. She chokes on her words and buries her face in her hands, shaking silently as she cries. Have you seen an escaped slave girl nearby? Escaped? She looks up at you, then through you. Tears roll, unheeded, down her cheeks. I don't know. I can't remember. How much for one of the rodent globes? She unconsciously raises a hand to where the rodents, in their tiny spheres, revolve around her head. One by one they touch her hand and the globes disappear, leaving the three tiny rodents sitting in her palm. The cat on her shoulder yawns and settles in for a nap. Well, now you can get the rats. Now you're going to go to sleep? Bay, boo, bao, hello again, she whispers, touching each of them with a gentle fingertip. They squeak appreciation at her attention, rubbing their cheeks against her finger as she looks up at you. They're not... Her voice breaks. She tries again, but can't. can't maintain eye contact. They're not for sale. She raises her hand, and through a mechanism you don't spot, each rodent re-enters its strong glass ball and resumes its wavering orbit. She thinks, they're like my children. I couldn't. But can I afford not to? Let me see what you have for sale first. She has Spray Flesh, Fleetford Moss, Cephalic Rush, Concentrated Spray Flesh. Oh. Double the hit points restored. Hyper Elutriated Force. 6 points of might. This crystal pulses and shimmers with barely contained energies, rapidly expanding and contracting. A needle protrudes from the crystal's center. If inserted into a vein, the crystal's amplified energies can be absorbed to increase the user's physical stamina and muscle mass by a great extent. These crystals are purified from a murky liquid found rarely in the Gravia Sound. When this purification process is done by particularly skilled hand and repeated several times, crystals of even greater power are born. Amplified Encephalic Rush. The substance was harvested from a vast structure in the beyond before being treated by the Order of Truth with processes to amplify the effects of the gaseous substance. When inhaled, the rush of mental energy is vastly more powerful. I'm pretty sure this is the same. Psychic Detonation. Deals 10 mental damage, confers daze to all characters ranged. These delicate glass spheres radiate a nauseating mental static from somewhere within their utterly clear depths. Ooh, what's this? Leucotic Bladder? Allies in immediate area. What's a cipher? Heals 13 points of health on all allies in range of target point. Slick to the touch and smelling of bile, this malleable organ can be smashed open to release a gout of healing viscera. Ugh. Good God. Pretty useful, though. Sylph Corn. Oh, a bonded item artifact. Plus one training and stealth skill, plus two damage on esoteric attacks. Negative, minus one training level and ranged weapon skill. Lengths of gossamer thread wind around this spindle covered in finely carved pictograms of transparent figures covered in and blinded by crisscrossing lines. Huh. Oh, don't hit that. Skolok's Archive. Artifact, bonded. Very expensive. Plus one training in lore machinery and lore natural. Plus two damage on esoteric attacks. Plus one damage per effort applied. Max plus eight on esoteric attacks. The negative effect is minus one training level in persuasion skill and minus three initiative. This bony segmented chain unravels at the touch of living flesh and latches eagerly onto a user's spine. Once attached, the user will sense the presence of another mind within their head that is wise, knowledgeable, and contagiously rude. I'm not going to buy anything. Now let's get a look at her and her cat. If you guys can see that well. The money from selling one of your rodents could really help you out right now. But why do we want it? They're not. She leans forward and buries her face in her hands, sobbing silently. Eventually, she wipes her eyes and sits up, raising a hand without looking at you. The three rodents crowd into her palm again, squeaking anxiously. She holds them close to her mouth and whispers words you can't hear. The rodents form a tiny circle, noses touching and twitching. After a few moments, she transfers one rodent into her other hand and returns the others to their strong glass globes. She thinks, where would one of you go? She seems a decent enough woman, and you would save the rest of us. Well, I'm guessing the one that would go is the one in her hand. Not in the globes. Bayo has agreed to go with you. I can sell her to you for 200 shins. Non-negotiable. She still won't meet your gaze and concentrates instead on patting Bayo with a single fingertip. Why not one of the others? She just shakes her head, mute and miserable. How much for all three, then? No! Her eyes betray surprise and horror as her voice sinks back to a whisper. No, please. Only Bayo is for sale. I changed my mind. You keep her. She glances up at you in surprise, attempting to smother her relief as she quickly returns Bayo to her strong glass home. Thank you, she says, a little breathlessly. She says, thank the gods around us. The money would not be worth losing Bayo. It's all for now. She says nothing, only returns to staring at the sea. Well, we didn't have money to pay you, that's why. Don't lie. Right over here. This facade is all the remains of a house. The rest has collapsed into the sea, hundreds of meters below. Oh, so that was her house. A months-old layer of dust cakes this sign, which reads, Scora the Wise, Scholar of the Iron Wind. That's not her. We were heard something about a Scora. Are these kids? Looks like two kids and someone playing a flute. Who may or may not be a kid. Zeb? A boy in rags holds out a hand as you pass. He is far too gaunt for his age. His knuckles stand out on his fingers like knots in a twig. Any shins for a family in need? Give him 5 shins, why not? Thank you, ma'am. Good fortune to you. I'm supposed to get gold. Gold tied. Is this your house? It doesn't look safe. We know. That's why we stay outside most of the time. Ever since Avina noticed some cracks around the walls, we only go into the in there to change clothes and stuff. Does anyone else live back here? There used to be a lady who lived next door, a nano sorceress, but she disappeared a while back. And there was a family 2 doors down. We heard them screaming on the night their house fell into the sea. He shudders and looks away. My sister Nim was friends with the little girl. Tell me about your family. He ducks his head. Yes, ma'am. There's 4 of us, counting my father. But he's gone to the bloom, and we don't know when he'll be back. He thinks, huh, I guess I really do think of him as family. I wish we could do more for him. I'm Zeb, and he points toward a little girl kicking a rock in a circle. That would be her. And an older girl who is playing a flute. You notice that they look considerably more well-fed than Zeb. That's Nim, my little sister. The girl with the flute is Avina. She's not actually our sister, but she's still family, and there's no one else. That's it. His eyes glance further down the street, then snap back to you. He smiles nervously. Tell me about your father. What's his name? How long has he been in the bloom? So many questions. His name is Zeb, too. Zebak Aralu. Aralau. And it's been a year at least. They went to work for the Memravira. For a while he sent shins back, but then they stopped. Haven't heard from him since. He squirms, uncomfortable. The bloom's like that, though. Sometimes it doesn't let anything out. I figure he's just waiting till it opens up again. He thinks, what if he's... No, he's fine. I'm sure he's fine. So many questions we can ask. He works in the bloom as a guard for the Memravira. We haven't heard from him for a while ago. Though, what do you know about the bloom? My dad always called it a schist hole, but he said it was a schist hole full of shins, so he was going to pull up his boots and wade in. He shrugs. I don't know much else about it. They say it's a monster, and people live inside. You can see it from the caravanserai, but they don't let anybody down there. Well, they didn't let me down there anyway. Is that glowing thing? He thinks, it looks scary to me. I can't believe Dad went down there. I don't know much worth telling. It's some kind of monster and people live inside. Crazy people. And things that aren't people. That's what my dad always said. If you go up to the caravanserai, you might be able to see it. What do you know about the Memravira? She's the boss in the Bloom. The mayor or something. My dad works for her. He's one of her guards. Is Nim okay? This life must be hard on her. She's okay. Doesn't know anything else, really. She misses our dad, though. His eyes cloud. She never really knew our mom, so at least she doesn't miss her. Tell me again about your sister. Nim doesn't understand how bad off we are. This is all she's known. I'd really like to make the house safe again, though, so she could sleep inside. Tell me about Avena. She's been with us ever since before I... Starting over. She's been with us since before Dad left, but she never said where she came from. Maybe she doesn't know. He looks across at Avena. I'm glad she's here. She notices things. Better look out than I am, and she catches a lot of shins with that flute of hers, too. She showed up a few years ago and lived with us and her dad. Never says anything about where she came from. Oh my god, the House of Empty Time. Are you sure there's only four of you? I saw you looking down the street. Is there someone else? Huh? He chokes. No, I'm just waiting on a friend. There's only four of us. No more, no less. He thinks, please don't investigate. They'll kill him. Really? Kill him? Who, the fifth member? Or his father? Can you tell me anything else about the area? Hardly anybody comes through here anymore. It's nice and quiet, I guess. Better than the rest of Cliff's Edge. That's all. If your father doesn't come back, I know a place where you could find a new home. It's called the House of Empty Time. We're not orphans. Our dad works in the Bloom. He's coming back. He thinks, unless he's... No, he's definitely coming back. Are you sure you won't consider going to the House of Empty Time? I told you we're not orphans. We're not going anywhere. Ook-a-dook. Good fortune to you, ma'am. Let's talk to Nim. Poor little Nim. A little girl in a patched tunic kicks a pebble while reciting in a sing-song voice. Joy, joy, joy. Sorrow, joy, 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 joy. Watch her play. Right. I'm trying to get information, right? I'm trying to, like, observe things, so that's how the blue tide, the, like, knowledge goes up. Joy, yay! She looks up at you. I got five in a row. She shrinks back as she realizes she's talking to someone she doesn't know. My brother usually talks to all the strangers. Can I ask you some questions? Nervous, she glances at the older boy nearby. I guess. Tell me about the game you're playing. It's called Sorrow and Joy. I made it up. Yeah, I noticed sorrow in there. She starts kicking the pebble again, first with her left foot, then with her right. You have to kick the rock left, right, without stopping. That's joy. If you kick it twice with the same foot, that's sorrow. Five joys in a row means you win. Five sorrows in a row, you lose. Is there any reason you use the word sorrow? Yeah, we're a little touchy about that word. I don't know. I just like it. Sorrow, sorrow. Joy, joy, joy. What's your name? Is this your house? My name's Nim, and this is my daddy's house, but he's not home right now. Only me and Zeb and Avena and Mittens the Monster live here now. We're waiting for Daddy to come back. Mittens the Monster? Okay, that's the fifth or fourth member. Well, he's the fifth member including Dad. He thinks, or she thinks, he said he'd come back now and then. I hope it's now. Mittens the Monster. Tell me who lives in your house again. Me and Zeb and Avena and And my daddy lives here too, but he never comes home. Tell me about Zeb. Zeb is my big brother. He takes care of us. He has a knife. He watches out for us until Daddy gets back. Who is Avina? She's my sister who isn't a sister. She plays the flute. She thinks, why isn't she my sister again? She's always been here. She's my big sister who isn't a sister. Where is your father? He's in the bloom, being a watchman. He's coming back any day now. She thinks, Daddy's strong. I miss him. He works in the bloom from the memorivoria. That's cute. Actually made it the word harder than it really is. Of course, I'm going to ask this last. Can I ask you about your neighbors around here? Her eyes fill with tears, and she looks down the road towards one of the fallen houses. My friend used to live over there, but she... Zeb interrupts. It's okay, Nim. You don't have to talk about that. He gives her a quick shake of the head and carefully wipes his sister's eyes. Well, now that we have Zeb's attention... And he's still all the way over here, this guy. Who is Mittens the Monster? He's our friend who lives in the alley. She thinks, Mittens is nice. I think he's sad, but at least he's got us. Zeb turns toward Nim suddenly. Nim, I told you not to talk about Mittens. He looks at you with a sheepish grin. Sorry, ma'am. Mittens is Nim's imaginary friend. He doesn't really exist. Maybe I can answer your questions. Nim nods. Yeah, Zeb knows everything. Ask him. I want to talk to you. The little girl is still playing her strange rock-kicking game, but her words are different now. Up, up, down, up, down. Up, 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 down, up, 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 yay! If and when you want. Your game has new words. Did you change the rules? Yes, it's an all-new game. She kicks the pebble. Now, if you do it right 5 times, your house stays up. If you do it wrong 5 times, it falls down. Makes it scarier. Alright. Interesting. Okay. Avina. A sister who isn't a sister. The girl stands outside a crumbling old house, playing the flute. She wears a simple dress, and her golden hair falls past her shoulders. The melody she plays is gentle and soft, but it somehow carries to every corner of the street. As you approach, she stops playing and smiles up at you with large green eyes. Shins for a song, ma'am? How much? It's 8 shins for a sad song, or 12 for a happy one. Why are sad songs cheaper than happier songs? Because there are more of them, ma'am. Can I ask some questions? Alright. Is this your house? Who lives here? Zeb and Nim and I live here, but it's their father's house. He's away. She looks back at the house. I wish she'd come back and fix it. I think it's going to fall down soon. Zeb and Nim and I live here. Zeb and Nim's father lives here too, but he's been gone a long time. I think it's going to fall down before he comes back. The house is in bad shape. She points to cracks around the base of the walls. Those weren't here before, and they're getting wider. We don't go inside anymore except to wash or dress. Then we come right back out. Where did Zeb's father go? He said he was going to work for someone named the Memorivora in the bloom. He was going to be a guard. She purses her lips. He said he would come back every now and then, but he hasn't. I don't know what happened to him. Tell me about Zeb and Nim. They're my friends. They miss their dad a lot, but we still have fun. Zeb watches out for us, and I'm teaching Nim to play the flute. They're almost my family. Tell me about yourself. I was from outside the city, but I've been here with Zeb and Nim ever since before their dad went away, so now I'm from here. Do you know who lived in the house next door? A lady named Skora. She was a nano sorceress, but a nice one. She let us look at all the things in her workshop. Well, almost everything. There was a room where she said she kept the Iron Wind. We weren't allowed in there. She frowns. I think maybe something bad happened to her. One day she wasn't there anymore, and she didn't say farewell. You said that a woman named Skoroi used to live next door? She was a nano-sorceress, and maybe a witch. I think she got in trouble. She went away one night and never came back. What do you know about the Iron Wind? Sounds familiar. Just that Skoroi thought it was dangerous. We never saw it, though. She shrugs. Maybe she was just pretending there was something bad in that room. I don't know. Have you heard of the House of Empty Time? It's a place where children with no family can go to find parents who love them. She shakes her head. I don't need to go to a place like that. This is my home. Farewell. Farewell, ma'am. How sad, though. Oh, what do we got in here?
Yes.
Yes! Loot! Yeah! 21 shins! Hell to the yes.
Of course.
Far below, you can see a ledge jutting out from the cliff face. A collapsed tunnel appears to have been once used to access the strange objects cradled in the corner. Oh, same. Alright. I can hear the flute now. Judging by the tiles, shingles, and bricks that are piled here, these are the remains of collapsed buildings, carefully pushed out of sight. What's that red thing that flashes? See that? It happens when I hold down the shift, or tab rather.
Allow me.
I don't want to stop playing. Oh, Stitches! Okay, guys, tune back next time when we deal with the Stitches and get loot. Thanks for watching. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.